my video is still being with you.
Thank you. so much for spending some time later to join today in Ruckus memory. Let's open in prayer. Our precious and loving Father, we thank you, Father, for watching over us in our times of joy and our times of grief. I pray right now, especially for Kathy, Father, that your comfort and peace through your Holy Spirit be upon her, allowing these folks together in this room, Father, to be in harmony, unity, and love today as we reflect on the memory of Robert. And I just pray that we be encouragers one to another in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
With deepest sorrow, we announce that Robert Alec Margolis, that would be Dr. Robert Alec Margolis, age 33, our most beloved son, family member, and friend, passed away suddenly in his sleep on Saturday, August 19th of 2023. Those who knew Rob, even just a little, know what a big heart he had, and there was a loss of shining light in their lives. Rob will be missed every day by his mother, Kathy, his loving aunts, Ginger, Marion, Sally, and Sherry, uncles, Barry, Dick, and Josie, Jose, cousins, and many great friends. Sorry. And we know that Rob is now with his father, Randy, along with his grandparents, uncles Buster and Jeff, as well as Aunt Beth, and is loved here on earth as well as in heaven. Rob devoted his life to music and education. He fell in love with playing the tuba at 12 years old and maintained that love throughout his life. He played in every ensemble available during junior high and high school, including 4 years with the Minnesota Youth Symphony. Rob continued his pursuits, earning a bachelor's degree of music theory from University of Wisconsin-Eau Claire in 2013, and a master in music performing at the University of Minnesota in 2015, and doctor of musical arts, tuba performance, with a certificate of music theory pedagogy from Arizona State University in 2019. He was a well-educated tuba player. That's an incredible paragraph of testimony there. And then came COVID, and COVID changed our world. If you live in and near Sun City, you know that personally. Rob loved helping people and teaching. He worked for Pearson Education as a scoring director and various school districts as a substitute teacher while he was working on yet another degree in math education with Western Governors University. He expected to graduate this year. He will be loved and missed as a son from Kathy. God bless you. Now, we are here not to be on the sad and downside, but on the upside as we celebrate Robert's life. And sadly, I never got to know Robert on this side of eternity. As God is merciful, I'll see him on the other side of eternity. And if heaven's choir has a tuba player, I'd expect him to be playing first four. And those are what Paul says in the Bible, as we have great, great hope, great expectation of eternity. But now it's time to offer to you, and I want you to think about this, get some preparation time. I'm going to have open mic for the floor, okay? Right after we have a song here. And during the song, I want you to think about anecdotal stories, maybe some funny stories that we all don't know that you could share. And I'm going to offer those right after our song. So right now I have Diane coming to sing Amazing Grace.
I
now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that turned my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious is that grace appeared the hour I first believed. When we
with Rob while we've been in Arizona. Rob was always up for a game night, friendship biscuits, or hanging in the pool. Rob and I had music in common. During the pandemic, My husband and I were staying at my parents' house next door to Kathy and Rob. Rob and I took this opportunity to figure out how to play cello tuba duets. It turns out this is an uncommon combination. It's sort of like one of those unlikely animal friendships between a cat and a dog. Finding obscure music and recordings and figuring out which notes we could each play on our respective instruments was part of the fun. It was rewarding for both of us to have a chance to play and to share this thing that we've been doing for years. One of my favorite of Rob's qualities was his sincerity. You always knew what he was thinking and that he was giving it to you straight. Sometimes this was a little humorous, like when we were rehearsing duets and he told me, "There's really no point in us working on this anymore until you've had a chance to practice." But he was always coming from a place of kindness. He was open, earnest, and thoughtful. I remember in particular how gentle he was with my husband and I and our dogs as our dogs were slowing down. Rob loved to laugh, and he loved making others laugh. He was playful, often self-deprecating, and clever. When he'd turn his head to share a smile, he reminded me so much of his dad. Sometimes he'd try a pun that would fall flat. And we would all laugh together at that, too. Our gatherings were full of love and laughter, and I'm grateful that we have all had this time with Rob.
Hi, my name is Joe Lasco. I was fortunate enough to know Rob. It's been a really devastating time, but I am fortunate to know that Rob and I were in good standing with each other before he passed. I'm also lucky to know that everything I'm about to say would not come as a surprise to Rob. In fact, Rob would probably be upset if I don't mention some stories from his years in Eau Claire. Rob and I met sometime around high school in Minnesota. We were in several honor bands, both tuba players, and both studied under the same teacher, Dr. Paul Booty. Eventually, we would both end up in Eau Claire. When Rob was a freshman, I was a junior. And Rob was incredibly comfortable in the band world and in class and as a student, but this was his first time away from home. And the world is a big, scary place, especially for Rob at that age. In the first week of college, the tuba studio, the group of students that all studied tuba, hosted a party at my house. This was still before phones had maps on them, so I had to give Rob instructions. Luckily, they were simple. Rob, leave the Haas Fine Arts building, go straight onto 2nd Street and keep going until you see a fence and then immediately turn left. That's where the house is. The party starts at 5. So about 5:15, I get a call from Rob. And this is his words verbatim. "Joe, I've been on 2nd Street forever. Did they move the fence?" "Rob, keep walking." Sure enough, Rob had only walked 2 blocks instead of the 3 he needed to spot the fence. As soon as Rob got there, everyone had a pretty good laugh, especially Rob. In fact, that became his favorite inside joke. And that was the magic thing about Rob. He never had an ego about himself, and he was willing to give anyone good company. A year later, Rob moved into the house, and we became roommates. Living with Rob was a treat. Rob and I were in the kitchen once, and he thought it would be funny to flatten his chicken to the rhythm of Rite of Spring, just to see if I was paying attention. Rob once got Paul Hindemith's Symphony in B-flat stuck in his head like an earworm and was humming it in the living room, and many of you don't recognize that name, but I'm gonna tell you right now, for you non-classical people, Paul Hindemith is not known for writing catchy little earworms. But where Rob and I bonded the most, I think, was the band room. I was fortunate enough to play third chair next to him and Calvin Greer in Wind Symphony. It was the highlight of my college career. I would get to listen to Rob play, and you could hear Rob play every musical symbol the exact way it was supposed to be played. I am confident I'm a much better player because Rob showed me what better playing could sound like. As tuba players, you get plenty of measures of rests. So Rob and I often use those times to tell jokes and rib each other. This is a respectful place, so I will not say any of the jokes. Sorry, Kathy, if you learned anything, that's not my fault. My favorite memory of Rob was how he turned pages on the stand. Rob was not the most dexterous person when it came to flipping paper. So to avoid turning pages, he would simply memorize entire pages of band music so he could avoid the process altogether. This somehow was less stressful to him. Like many people after school, Rob and I drifted apart. It wasn't until the pandemic that I tried to reach out to people I hadn't talked to in a long time. Rob responded almost immediately, and it was like we never lost touch. We shared struggles, stories, and laughs. Reconnecting was one of the best things I ever did. Many people will tell you that the book is always better than the movie adaptation. In most cases, they're right, but The Wizard of Oz is an obvious exception to that rule. However, there's one story that didn't make it into the movie that's so good. I'm gonna explain it right now. So Dorothy, Scarecrow, Tin Man, and the Lion are all walking on the yellow brick road. And the Tin Man gets behind because he doesn't want to accidentally step on any bugs or beetles. He explains to the group that because he doesn't have a heart, he has to be extra careful as to not hurt anything. And there was no one more Tin Man-like than Rob. Rob knew, due to his Asperger's, that he could struggle in social interactions. So he made sure to talk to everyone he could, listen intently, and treat everyone with decency. Which means that he was often the most sociable person in the room. He made it look so easy to like everybody. There are things in life that we believe without any facts. We just know it in our hearts. For many, it's a form of faith. Something for me that I was so certain of is I was gonna get to play with Rob again. I had no evidence, no proof, but I was so sure. I hate being wrong. I love the Rob in the suit.
It didn't get in here, but there's room for additional memories for you to add. This is a gift for you, Kathy, of everyone's testimonies and mine. My name is Jenna Skabel, or Hochschild as Rob and I met in kindergarten. Growing up, which there's a handful of pictures in there from kindergarten. kindergarten, third grade, I don't know, to both falling in love with Pokemon and Digimon. It was real. We both knew Pokemon was superior. eating the white raspberries from their bush in the backyard, which I thought was just astonishing as a child that there were white raspberries. To our love of Nickelodeon and the Kanan and Cal show. Welcome to the Good Burger, home of the Good Burger. Can I take your order? We would reenact parts of shows when we would play. And one of our favorites was the library scene from All That. Rob would sit on the couch in their living room and pretend to be a kid in the library, and I would walk around as the librarian. Every time he would be too loud, I would yell at him, "Shh, this is the library!" And he would laugh and laugh, and he would go back to being quiet, and we'd just do it for hours. If you've seen the show, you know exactly what I'm referring to. If you haven't seen it, it might sound silly and weird, but that's just what we were. Silly friends, we weren't afraid to be weird or different around each other, because what is normal anyways? I never had to hide my personality. We were basswood bulldogs from kindergarten to third grade, and then boundaries changed. We were OPU ocelots from fourth to sixth, and sixth grade we joined band and continued at Maple Grove Junior High and played some really cool music. And we kept those memories through high school, where we were both in marching band and his little marching band classes. 5 years, my sister's four, because he did honor guard before me, so he beat me on that, I guess. It's fine. But in marching band and high school band, we went on trips together with the groups. We went to New York and Boston, Germany and Austria, Colorado. And another really cool experience we had was at the showcase concert at Orchestra Hall. We both started to form other friendships throughout high school, but Rob was always part of them because everyone loved Rob. Rob Dog, sorry to be exact, from high school, was an integral part of our school's music programs. That was apparent our senior year music awards night when both of our names were called to the stage to receive the John Philip Sousa Award, the pinnacle award given to a student for being someone the band wouldn't thrive without. And I remember that night. I was thinking, up on that stage, here we are, from kindergarten to this moment, how cool to get this award together. Rob and I went to different colleges, but still got together when he was in Minnesota with the alumni band at the Osseo Lions Roar Parade, or an occasion in the summers when everyone was back home. And after he moved to Arizona, those interactions were further between, because you know, flights aren't always the cheapest and it's a long drive, but anytime we would connect, it was as if no time had passed. Just like you had said too, it's a true testament to friendship. In 2016, Rob and Kathy flew to Minnesota for a wedding where Rob was an usher. I told my husband, I don't care how Rob is involved in the wedding, but he needs to be involved. He's been my friend since kindergarten. So whatever it is, he's in it, period. No discussion, he's in the wedding somehow. But since then, it wasn't until this past March that I was to see him again. I said for years, I'll fly out in the crazy Arizona heat to see you guys. July flights are cheap, because who wants to come out here in July, right? And it just never happened. But then this year it did. And I am so happy it did. That was the first thing I said to Kathy when she called. I'm so glad I came out. I was gonna go see my dad in California, and I called Kathy and just kind of invited myself to stay with them for a couple days, which of course was no problem. And once again, hanging out with Rob was like no time had passed. We just picked up where we left off and enjoyed each other's company and friendship. I learned a new game in March, just one. Very fun. And now forever that game will have a connection and memory with Rob. This is my last part. One thing with family is that you have two of them. You have the family that is your aunts, uncles, parents, siblings, that family you're kind of stuck with, you know, whether you like them all the time or not. But your second family is the one you choose, your friends. In Mrs. Swanson's kindergarten class in 1995, Robbie and I chose each other to be friends. And over the years, it was apparent that he and Kathy and Randy were so much more than that. They were my chosen family. I love you, Robbie. Thank you for being my friend and my family. This is for you. We'll put it out at lunch if you want to add things, but flip through and see if your name's in there, because I just copied and pasted everyone's things.
So my name is Ryan Black, by the way. I'm Krista's husband. And the segue that Jenna provided here is going to be one of my favorite memories that we've had over the last 3 years. We're playing games with Rob, family and friend game night, which a number of you were able to partake in. And so the game, it is actually just one. And it's a truly amazing game. You all should go and get it. I don't get any sort of kickback or anything like that. But really, it's a wonderful game. It's a simple game. It's a team-based game. And so you were working together to try to get someone to guess a particular item, a phrase, or a word, or something like that. And the catch is that, this is one of the cards from it, the catch is that the person that's guessing can't see the word, of course, and then you come up with one word and one word alone to try to prompt that person about what the item is. And you work together as a team to come up with sort of a menu of words to cue them on that. And so we're playing, the picture might even be in this slide deck, but we're playing the game, and so this card comes up, and the Rob picks number 5. And so we all write down dutifully our numbers, or actually I might have been the guesser now that I think about it, but so everyone writes down the words, and so the prompt was Rambo. And so for those of you that are up on your 1980s cinematic masterpieces, so this is the Sylvester Stallone running around the jungle in a tank top with a red bandana on, shooting things, right? So we all put things down, or everyone puts things down. They put down things like Stallone, bandana, jungle, movie. Rob writes down Michael. The critical thing to know, to understand the story then, is the full name of Rambo is John Rambo, not Michael Rambo. And so that's one of the great things about the game, is that you can just end up with this clue that is like a complete red herring, where it just sends you down the wrong rabbit hole. And so not only did we get an amazing laugh at the time, but Rob made a huge contribution to the future playing of that game, which is any time someone comes up with a clue that doesn't make any sense at all, it's just a Michael clue. And so that's something that, and there are so many other wonderful game experiences we have. Lots of pictures up here of Sally banging on Rob with an inflatable club in caveman poetry. I've got the live photo of it if you want to see it in more like video form. It's actually worth it, trust me. And so he was just so much fun, and it brought such an energy and enthusiasm to everything they did, including games. And so it really made our time that we were spending down here really memorable and something that we appreciate and will obviously miss. So. I just wanted to have the opportunity to share that particular memory with you all. And you should really should check out the game. It's a very, very good one.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
I'm Sally Jenkins. I'm one of the aunts. Rob was really interested in a lot of things, and as a result, he was a very interesting person. And in his obituary message, Kathy had mentioned music and education, and so there's a tie to both of those. His music connection was awesome. It gave him a chance to have this close relationship with his dad and his long-lasting friends, that he was able to nurture those relationships through his love of music. He had a chance to be on stage and show the world how talented he was in a very public setting. He had a chance to travel the world because of his music connections. And travel wasn't always easy for Rob, especially in the very beginning. He went to music camp at the Peace Gardens and had to make a flight, a solo flight, to land in Minot, North Dakota, where we would pick him up. And he called me for several days ahead, saying, "How will I find you? You know, how will I locate you in the Minot Airport?" We had one gate. And I kept assuring him, don't worry, Rob, when you get off the plane and walk through the door, I will make eye contact with you. And you could see that he walked through the door and he was looking, and once eye contact was made, he was just so relieved. And as we walked over to the one carousel to pick up his luggage, he stood right up next to the carousel and was watching all of the black bags come through. And he turned to Dick and he said, "Dick, if you see a tuba, it might be mine." And we were very lucky because there was a tuba that came through, probably the only one that year, but it was Rob's. And so I took him up to camp and had to go into this dorm where there were probably 10 or maybe more bunk beds, and he had to find his bunk mate and meet this person for the first time and sleep in this open room with all of these people. And so we found his bunk mate, and here was this kid who was athletic and tan and had bleached spike hair and a beaded necklace. And I thought, oh, this will be interesting. And Rob met this kid, and within 5 minutes, I needed not to be there because it was the first time I'd really seen how Rob could talk to anyone about any subject at any time. And these two guys were talking tuba. They knew the language of tuba, so that was fine. That went out very, very, very well. So we got him situated. He had his week at music camp. Kathy drove up so that we could enjoy his concert at the end of this. And Rob actually had landed a solo part, which was really fun. I think it was probably four notes or something, but it was a solo that he got to play. And so I knew he had played in the youth orchestra, so I knew he was going to wear his real stuff rather than a white t-shirt and black jeans like many of the kids were. So Rob went and got ready. He came out, was ready to go play his solo in this big concert that we were attending. And it didn't take very many minutes for us to remind him to carefully unbutton the shirt and button it up again so they all match. Because they didn't. And to tuck in his tail, because that was out. And it was at first not noticeable, but his belt buckle was on his hip, so we had to get that moved over. And once that was done, and Rob was all dressed, ready to go, he had a chance to go in and really shine one more time at his concert. Rob was always so eager and so earnest and so sincere and so kind and so willing to help. And our time here in Arizona has been truly enriched by the time we've been able to spend with Rob.
My name is Dick Jenkins, and I'm Sally's husband, and Kathy's brother, and Rob was my nephew. And my story about Rob is about maybe something that wasn't one of his strengths, and that was anything physical. When I was growing up, I was fortunate to grow up and have access to a lake place in Minnesota that my parents had. And as the years went by, Sally and I purchased that from our parents, and it became our lake place. And we had three girls, and because Rob didn't have any siblings, those three girls became important in his life. And they helped me teach Rob the sport of kayaking. And that's one of my favorite memories of Rob. Is, if you can imagine, Rob's not a small person, and this is a 10-foot yellow plastic kayak. And the trick, first of all, is to get into it, because you don't sit on top, you slide into it. And I admit to difficulty with that myself. But then the second trick is to navigate your way on the lake and not tip over or sink. And Rob was very nervous about this, and my daughters were very kind to help him out. And I was just hoping for the best. And we got him in the kayak, and he took off, and the issue was balance. And he couldn't get the balance down, and it kept getting worse, and finally he sank. and my point in telling this story about Rob is not to embarrass him, but it's to point out that we all have gifts in different ways. And his gifts were other things. And that's what was important to me, is he was able to try something that he wasn't skilled at and fail, but still had a good time. And I'll remember Rob for trying.
All the way in the back, if you don't mind.
Hi, everyone. I'm Deanna Swoboda, one of Rob's tuba teachers at Arizona State University. Teachers aren't supposed to have favorites. But we do, right? And Rob was definitely a favorite. I met Rob through one of his former teachers, Jerry Young, at Eau Claire. Yeah. And Jerry called me and said, "Boy, do I have a student for you. This guy, he's great. He's a great tuba player, he's a great musician, and above all, he's just a wonderful person, and you will completely enjoy studying with him." Rob made the trip to audition at Arizona State University. Rob and I bonded from this very moment of him arriving with his tuba, because that's what we do. We do a lot of this, playing our tuba. He came to my office, and we had a short lesson before his audition. And Rob, he was getting his tuba, he opened his case, and he was getting his tuba and everything out, and he leaned down. Now, I'm telling this story. You remember this? Yeah. Thank you, Rob. Now, we did laugh about this at graduation. So, Rob, he bent down, opened his case, he was pulling out his tuba, and I heard, and this is what I saw. I saw. Now, Rob and I had just met. I was going to be his teacher, and his pants had ripped, and he was getting ready to go into his audition. He had his best tie on, his best clothes on, and he's like, "What am I going to do? I can't do this audition. I can't go in there." And I said, "Yes, you can. I happen to have a graduation robe in my closet." So I pulled out the graduation robe. Rob got to wear the graduation robe at his audition. And we saved the day. And at graduation, he said, "Dr. Swoboda, do you remember that day?" And yes, I do. He saved me. Thank you so much. Rob, just to echo all of the comments prior, that Rob was such a kind, loving, giving human being and wonderful musician. He was loved by his peers. And we'll be missed. Thank you.
I didn't get to see that facial expression, but I was shocked. Don't want to cut anyone off. Is there anyone with a final thought? All right. If you came in today and picked up one of those little cards, if you fish for that card, because that's how I want to open my concluding remarks, my sermon, if you will, with that card. We pick up these little cards at every funeral memorial service. We keep them. I keep them often in my Bible, little bookmarks, mementos of the person that card represents. But I want to draw your attention on that card to right under where it says Robert Allen Margolis, November 13, 1989, August 19, 2023. The dates are important because all of us have day timers and calendars and things that remind us of dates and important things. But what I want to draw your attention to is something that we all of us in this room, including Robert, have in common, and that's the dash between the dates. Right now, you're living in your dash. There was a time when you were born. There will be a time when you die. And Robert, sadly, in spite of all the joy that he brought to your lives, as witnessed by the testimonies, he only lived the 33 years that God gave him on this earth. And that was his dash. All of our thoughts, all of our memories, one day someone will reflect on your life the way that I am here to represent Robert's life. And all of that is culminated in that small dash of time. When I went to my Bible to reflect some verses to share with you today, I thought of someone else who only had a very brief time of 33 years to say everything that he had to say. And then he was gone from this life into an eternal life. And that was the person of Jesus Christ. During his life, as Robert attained, and I know the work that's represented in these degrees and in that little diploma, he attained the education that represented a doctorate degree. Well, with Jesus and his time on earth, they called him a rabbi. And rabbi was a master of the law. He was a doctor in his own right. And Jesus taught us, and it's recorded, of course, in the four gospels as perspectives of what Jesus taught, that Paul wrote some 13 other books reflecting on the life of Christ. The things that in a short period of time we can learn from someone's life, and the Bible represents those things that we learn about Jesus. I want to reflect, thinking about the leaders in the Bible, on King David. King David was, according to one verse in the Bible, a man after God's own heart. He was a king of Israel. He was probably the most victorious military leader that Israel ever had. And God said it was God's heart that he loved this man, King David. I like David's story because they don't leave out all of David's mistakes in his life. He made mistakes. If you remember the famous, there's been a movie made about David and Bathsheba, his affair that he had with the neighbor lady, and that resulted in the birth of a child. And wow, if I were writing someone's life story, I'd probably want to omit that chapter. It would be kind of embarrassing, but it's there for all of us to read and learn from. And one of the things that happened, as recorded in the book of 2 Samuel in the Old Testament, is that David had a son with Bathsheba. and it doesn't say the exact age, but I imagine 10 or 12 years old, that child became very, very sick. David had other children that he loved, especially this son. And when the son was stricken and in his deathbed, David took off his kingly robes and laid them aside, and he put on his own body sackcloth, burlap, and anointed his head with ashes to show his grief before God of his stricken son. And he stayed day and night at the child's bedside, and the servants would come and see the king of the whole nation weeping over the sickness, the illness of the son. And it came to pass that the son died. And David got up and he asked the servants to bring a basin of water, and he washed his face. He put back on his kingly robes and he went back to work being the king of Israel. And it was such a remarkable transference from going in grief and ashes of mourning to back to his regular job of being the king that the servants were shocked. And here's what the verses say in 2 Samuel chapter 12. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came into the house of the Lord and worshiped. David has just lost his most dearly beloved child. And the result was he worshiped God. That shows you his heart. And then he came down to his own house where he required, and they set bread before him, and he did eat. And this stunned his servants. Imagine the transformation that the servants have seen day after day after day. So verse 21 says, and then said his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive, but when the child was dead, thou didst rise up and eat bread. And he said, and this is profound, and I want you to catch this. He said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me and that the child may live? But now that he is dead, wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? And when a child goes to heaven, the last thing a parent on earth would want to do is bring him back into this world. Trust me on that. So David said, should I bring him back again? It's a rhetorical question. But he says, and think about this, I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. In the New Testament, Rabbi Paul said that this is what we call a blessed hope. When someone dies, giving us the hope that they trusted in God for their eternity in heaven, then we can go and be with them. And as the obituary for Robert read today, I would just like a glimpse of heaven to see the uniting of a father and son in the presence of a gracious Savior, Jesus Christ our Lord. We who are alive and remain, Paul said, you know, we can be caught up, we can see that with great expectation. In the book of Ecclesiastes, written by the heir to David, Solomon, Ecclesiastes says, then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return to God who gave it. And I want to leave you with words of comfort and peace that Robert has created in our minds as he touched our lives, all of these memories. Funny stories, sad, grieving times, maybe of sickness and illness, but all of these memories. But he is now in the presence of God. And Paul said, again, Rabbi Paul, writing to the Philippians, said in Philippians 3, who shall change this God? Who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned into the likeness of his glorious body, Jesus' glory, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things, even to himself. And I'll conclude with this verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. friends and family gathered here together, I want you to consider the loss that Kathy has had with first her husband, and now not just a son, but her only child, her beloved son. And in the days ahead, I would love to see you as God in his grace comforts us about with his spirit to give us comfort and peace. I'd love to see you reach out to her and comfort her as well. A phone call, a hug, not too much that we would expect from loved ones and friends. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Precious and loving Father, again, we thank you, Father, for what you have done for us. You have gone to prepare a place for us that when we pass, we can expect with great expectation the joy of heaven, to be in your presence, to be in the presence of loved ones who have gone before us, Father, because of their testimony of faithfulness. And Father, as we pray right now in the memory of Robert, that you would add peace and comfort to subdue the sorrow, and I know the sorrow will be there, the sorrow of loss. But I pray that over the days ahead that you would replace that sorrow of loss with the hope of great expectation of seeing a reunion and a fellowship again for all of eternity. We can trust that, we can believe that, because we believe you are a great God watching over us, caring for us, and preparing a place for us. And we thank you in your son's name. Amen. The concluding part of the service, it'll be a two-part thing. You are all welcome to stay for a food fellowship. Get to know one another. Some of you are from Minnesota, I understand. And I happen to have the joy of having been to Ely, Minnesota. And I still have the flylight scars on me somewhere from being not a kayak, but a canoe on the Boundary Lakes up there. So we have things in common. I want you to enjoy food at the table. The food's prepared right outside the door. And as you go out, please just feel free to get up, go out, bring your food back to your table and chat. But during that time that you're getting the food, there will be about a 13-minute video presentation of a wonderful, I believe it's a duet here, a wonderful duet of music. And don't just get fixated on the screen and forget to eat, though. So we've already prayed. You are dismissed. And you're all on